My name is Ted Forbes, and welcome back to another episode of The Art of Photography. And today, we're going to do another colorist, and I think we are probably covering the classic ultimate colorist of the history of photography today, which is a gentleman by the name of William Eggleston. And, you know, it's interesting because the last three episodes, we've been really carrying on with this historical placement of where color falls in fine art photography. And when I was trying to come up with a subject to talk about today, I think William Eggleston is actually perfect at this point, because in many ways, he's one of my favorite people to talk about because his work is slightly controversial. It's very difficult for some people to deal with, and at the same time, others are just simply in love with it. I happen to really like his work myself, and I want to stay fairly neutral in those terms today because he is one of the most significant photographers, definitely for color in the history of photography, and that's what I want to make the point of because it's a pretty interesting story that I want to share with you about this. So with Eggleston's work, I think there are kind of two things that I want to cover that are going to kind of put this into a little bit of perspective. One, I think, is Eggleston's own background and where he came from and how he ended up becoming a photographer. And two, the placement of where we are in terms of photography's acceptance with color photography's acceptance as fine art. By this point, Eggleston, of the guys that we've been talking about recently, Saul Leiter, Fred Herzog, Eggleston's considerably younger than those guys, and he came out a little bit later. But as I've mentioned before, at this point in history, and I'm talking about the 1950s, 1960s, we had developed color photography. It was commercially available. But you didn't see a lot of printing of color photographs. And there's a couple reasons for this. One, the expense of it, certainly. Most magazines were published in black and white, with some exceptions. Just where we are in terms of technology at this point in the 50s, coming forward to the 1960s. And I think this is what makes this pretty interesting because, you know, in some regards, the process of making a color print, I think, is probably what's holding photography back somewhat. There are a couple other reasons, but that's one of the big things. It's why museums aren't exhibiting color photography at this point. They're dealing with traditional process. They're dealing with a lot of black and white, and that's what's generally regarded and accepted as real photography or real fine art photography in those terms. And so color is just something you don't see a lot of. And as I mentioned before, guys like Fred Herzog or especially Saul Leiter, they were not really known as colorists or, you know, even though their work is definitely of that period, there's a sense of nostalgia that we talked about. They weren't really recognized until much later. And Saul Leiter really, you know, he had a career as a black and white photojournalist, fashion photographer. His color works were not known until the 1990s when he had this large collection of personal work that gets discovered. So this is kind of where we are. And I'm setting the stage for William Eggleston to come along here. Now, I want to talk a little bit about William Eggleston, where he comes from. He's still alive today. One of my favorite photographers. He was born in 1939 in Memphis, Tennessee, and raised in a middle-class family. He, as a child, was interested in music, electronics, making things, and, you know, a little bit of art, but was not a photographer until he got to college. He went to boarding school, and there's a reason I'm making this point, because I think it relates to what you're going to see a lot of in his work, and has said publicly that he had a pretty miserable experience there in terms of fitting in, kind of this Spartan attitude of the school and, you know, this conformist attitude. And of course, you know, you have a guy like Eggleston who, you can see this in his work, is very unique and very different and really doesn't care what anybody else thinks in a lot of ways. And there's a real beauty that comes out of them. I think this shapes how he ends up kind of becoming as a photographer, if that makes sense. And, you know, what happens is he goes on to college, spent at least 5 years in various schools, never got a degree. But it was during this time when he was at Vanderbilt that a friend of his gave him his first camera, which was a Leica. And if any of my friends ever wanted to give me a Leica, I'd be thrilled, but that's beside the point. Anyway, so he goes off to college, and after receiving the Leica, enjoys taking pictures and studies art a little bit more formally when he goes to Ole Miss. And through a series of visiting artists, discovers that he loves abstract expressionism and other, you know, work that's being produced by, you know, avant-garde painters of the time. And so, anyway, so that's where Eggleston's coming from on that side of things. Later went to go teach at Harvard. We're going to come back to this in a second. So as far as the photography landscape at this time, you have, really, as I mentioned before, you don't have color being a prominent thing that you're going to find in museums or galleries. So if you were a color photographer, your resources for getting out and becoming known are very limited in the 60s. So about 1969, Eggleston gets a meeting with the director of photography at the Museum of Modern Art in New York, a guy named John Sarkowski, who is one of the pivotal figures. He was a curator, he was the director of photography at MoMA, and his predecessor was Edward Steichen. So very heavy company, obviously. And, you know, I think Sarkowski really changed the world of photography. I mean, you know, some of the people he discovered, like Winograd or Dean Arbus, or in our case now, William Eggleston. And so he is to thank for just a lot of what we consider the second half of the 20th century of modern photography really came through MoMA, and they were really plowing ground on that. Sarkowski unfortunately died a few years ago, but he was a very central pivotal figure in terms of what, you know, this modern element is coming in. So he has this chance meeting, which I believe he kind of described as being out of the blue, with William Eggleston. And he also described him as kind of this weird kid with a suitcase of, I think he put dime store photo prints. And this is all he had. I mean, it was come in with stuff that literally was done in the drugstore on whatever machine they had. And this is how he was showing his art. And Sarkowski goes back to the board and convinces them to, as an acquisition, purchase one of Eggleston's pieces. And so that was probably late 60s something, 68, 69. I don't know my dates exact. So the following couple of years, Eggleston is at Harvard teaching and faculty there. And about that time, dye transfer process comes out. And this is a commercial printing process that is not only inexpensive, but Eggleston was very impressed with the vibrancy and the colors that are in a lot of these inks that are being used. And being someone who's very interested in color photography, he had really no means to actually blow these up and reproduce them in the kind of quality and the kind of, you know, brilliance that, you know, would convince an art museum otherwise. Now, what happens is, this is about 1976, I believe, is that MoMA actually does a full show of William Eggleston images. And this is really considered to be the groundbreaking watershed moment for photography, because it's the moment where a major show that becomes extremely successful and extremely different and extremely weird and avant-garde and embraces a lot of the late 60s and early 70s, but it's photography and it's color. This is the first time that it ever happened. Now, MoMA had previously shown some color works by certain people like Ernst Haas, but this was the first big one. And so I think that sets the stage for us, is those two things. You have Eggleston, who's coming along and is very much a nonconformist, very much going to do things his way, and has a real eye to him. And then you have this climate that's just absolutely perfect right at this point, where you all of a sudden have this process where he's going to make prints, and you have a curator at a major art gallery or major museum who's willing to showcase it. So that's where we come from. So what I want to do now is, we're going to go over and look at some of Eggleston's work, and I'm going to talk you through this because it's very different. It seems to be he's one of those guys you either love or you hate, and I love him, and I'm going to try to show you why. And again, I'm trying to remain neutral somewhat, because of, you know, I just think his importance as a figure in modern photography. So come on over and let's check out the work of William Eggleston. Okay, so we are going to use Pinterest once again for our presentation here today. And if you guys want to follow along, just in case you didn't know, you can go to Pinterest. And if you want to look at some of these images on your own and click on links and stuff, my account is pinterest.com/TedForbes, all one word, TedForbes. And if you scroll all the way down to the bottom, when you see my boards page, which is at that URL, there's two in particular, and I want to take a quick glance at someone else before we get into Eggleston. This is a gentleman named William Christenberry, and it would be kind of fun to do a whole show on Christenberry. But William Christenberry is a photographer who kind of, in a lot of ways, was largely responsible. Sorry, Pinterest is being buggy here. Let's reload. For encouraging Eggleston to pursue a career in, as a photographer. And Christenberry is kind of known for these very stark, front-sighted American 1950s rural structures. And so here's one of these, I assume it's a church or a schoolhouse, and there's some others in here as well. And what's interesting is these images he actually shot that just very simply color on a Kodak Brownie. They were, you know, very cheap camera, and if you blow these up, you can actually see that it blurs just like you would expect a Brownie too. And I think this is kind of the mark that paved the way for some of what William Eggleston was going to be doing. And Christenberry actually took these images. He was a painter as well, and they were simply studies for his own personal use that he was going to use for a series of paintings that he was working on. And they've kind of become known as this, you know, kind of in an obscure kind of way, for those who dig deep enough, this wonderful little collection of early color photos. And that's what William Crissenberry is kind of known for. And these are all really cool. They're just a little slice of life Americana, just very stoic front-facing structures, usually freestanding. Sometimes there's, you know, like a trailer back here, this 5 cent sign. Anyway, kind of cool stuff. And Crissenberry was one of the people who knew Eggleston and talked him into, you know, encouraged him to become a photographer. And I think that is the significant part of that. So what we're going to do is now we're going to flip over and navigate the Pinterest. Let's go all the way down and let's go ahead and check out William Eggleston and view some of his work. And I want to start with two early black and white images that I just adore. There's one of a secretary in an office building, and there's another one of this car. And I think what you start to see here, this is very post-Robert Frank, and I think this is where you're going to start seeing Eggleston come into his own. These are early, they are black and white, and what's interesting about them is that, you know, if you're looking for beauty, if you're looking for classic rule of thirds, classical composition techniques, if you're looking for, you know, just this pristine, you know, presentation, you're not going to find it here. These are a little odd. They're, in some ways, you might define them as even being poorly taken, out of focus in areas, blurry in areas, and the camera's not really even lined up or being held straight. But this creates an interesting aesthetic and a juxtaposition that you're going to see carried through in a lot of this work. And I think William Crissenberry's work, when we're looking at it, had a little similar effect. Although those were taken to be studies for paintings, where seemingly he would clean up details later. What you have here is something that, where you have all the symmetry, but it's thrown off by that camera being thrown off. It's completely intentional. And I think it's one of the charming things about it is almost this snapshot kind of feel to a lot of this stuff that you're going to see. And this carries over into some of the color work as well. Like, for instance, this image that looks like it's taken either on a motorcycle or in the rearview mirror of a car or something, because you have this blurred image with a reflection at the bottom. But I love the way this is just this city street. You're right in the middle. There's a guy about to ride off on a motorcycle. A dog is lying in the road. But there is this real sense of open space in this composition within the perspective. And things seem like they may be just thrown in or in random places. But I really think that this becomes decisive moment stuff. Now, some of you may disagree with me. I understand. And you're going to have to get over the fact that I love Eggleston. So, personally, I don't shoot like this, but I love it and I'm a huge fan of it. Sometimes even with people, there's a very almost a somber sense of isolation where you're not really connecting with some of these people in a very warm way. There's not a sense of whimsical nature or personality necessarily. It's pretty much expressionless faces looking right at you. But at the same time, I think that there really is something that draws you in on here. And what Eggleston is doing with this, and I don't know if this is picking up on the video or not, but he's using color. And if you look at the vibrancy and the blue in this kid's shirt, that's what you're going to start to see in Eggleston's work. Now, we're kind of talking about the starkness and oddness and I think probably uncomfortable nature of some of these compositions, like this woman, you know, with this jarring flash next to a brick wall at night. But I want you to start seeing the color, the shades, how color works together. The first image that kind of made a huge splash with Eggleston was this one, which is called Red Ceiling. And by today's standard, you know, we're bombarded with color, we're bombarded with imagery, and it's harder to look at this image in context, I think, in the day that we're living in now. At the time, though, this was groundbreaking. The fact that it was, and I hate the fact we're doing this in a video too, because I think you need to see an original print of this, because there's a vibrancy to the red, and Eggleston has gone on record as saying he's never sure that he got it right how he wanted it to look. But this vibrancy of red, if you kind of, I think a modern example you might be able to compare this to, if you're familiar with the Amish Kapoor sculpture that's in Chicago of the giant chrome bean. Well, the bean isn't revolutionary, and it's rather large, and we've seen that before, but the fact that it's this galumphing, you know, anthropomorphic or biomorphic chrome blob that's coming at you, the chrome is what has a big impact on the way we perceive that piece. I think this is almost the Chicago bean of photography in the sense, but it's not chrome. In the sense, it is this red, which is the color that dries most sensitive to. Now, this is a very crude image. There's something very uncomfortable about all the wires that are plugged into the light fixture that's in the middle of this red ceiling. Why it's blood red, I don't know. There's a certain sense of creepy or low-budget horror film that starts coming out of this, which you see where I'm going with this. This is intentional, and this is what he was trying to set up. And even more strange is the small diagram that's barely in the bottom of the image of stick figures in various suggestive sexual positions. And it's a different photo if that's not there. So, you know, these little things that seem like they're you know, accidents in the composition, or they, you know, we didn't move the camera or frame it up correctly. Well, they're there for a reason. And like I've said before, with composition, when you put things close to the edge, they end up having a lot of weight to them. And this is a weird juxtaposed photo where you have something that has a lot of weight next to the edge, being that poster back there, and then you have something in the middle, and they're definitely creating a weird, creepy vibe. So, you know, you have that sense in his work. This is a lesser known piece, but another one of my favorites is this Green Window, and really exploring what color is going to do in photography at this point, because again, black and white is what we're dealt with at this point. Another thing that's kind of interesting too, and you see this theme come up a lot in Eggleston's work, are situations of things that normally are associated with people, and there's no people in these images, like all these dolls on the front of this Cadillac, which is beautifully bizarre with this wonderful sky in the back, but there's no humans in the image. So it's creating these situations, kind of like, where did people go and what, how did this get here kind of thing. Another one of this grill with a red axe and an extension cord on the ground, and the way that this reddish orange permeates this image amongst the green, and you know what it looks to be kind of an overcast day it was shot on. Imperfect photo, but there's some amazing experimental things going on here. Definitely, if you cue in kind of abstract expression. And then also there's the famous image of the tricycle with no humans in the image either. Now, the other interesting thing about the tricycle, and I have talked about this on the show before, and this is probably my favorite Eggleston image. One is where this is shot from. It's shot from the ground up. And because of the perspective and proximity of the tricycle to the houses in the back, the tricycle looks huge. This tricycle is actually probably very small, obviously, but there's just kind of a little bit of an optical thing that's going on, and it just happens to be a color photo that I think, just for whatever reason, this is one of those images that really speaks to me. Another famous image that you may agree less with is the freezer with frozen food and a lot of frost intact. It's another one that I believe MoMA owns. One of the more beautiful images, I think, is these two women smoking at a diner. I've showed this on the show as well. I think this is more in line with what you see guys like Saul Leager or Fred Herzog doing. But just, you know, beautiful color, the way the color works together, you know, these reds and greens being complementary colors, quite interesting. Another famous one is this woman sitting on the yellow curb here. Just a really bizarre pose. There's a shadow on the ground that's in the way, and you know, like I said, at first glance, sometimes these look like almost accidental, just not thought through shots at all, and that's not the case. I'm going to end this with a shot that Eggleston did, and this is one that he did, I believe it was for the Wall Street Journal when they were doing a story, and there's just something very comical about this. This is Eggleston's foot and his camera bag, and it's a quirky little shot, and what he's doing with 20-some-odd Leicas that are all kind of the same thing, I have no idea, but probably focal length differences, some are loaded with film, you just go out and go, I don't know. But anyway, it's kind of a fun shot to end this on. So anyway, that is William Eggleston. I hope that, you know, if this work speaks to you, you probably found it enjoyable. If Eggleston doesn't speak to you, I hope that you give it a second shot and try to look at it in the context of which it is from. And I think you will start to notice, you know, particularly with these wild colors and these brilliant, you know, this is what he's doing. He's communicating in color, and it's the first time this has ever been done in the fine art world, and it literally changed everything for the future of photography. So I hope that what you're seeing here with the work of William Eggleston is, whether or not it's something you enjoy or not, I think you have to look at its importance in the history of photography. And I can't harp on this enough. I'm one of the people, I'm on the side, I love William Eggleston's work. Sometimes it's weird, sometimes it's not something that's a beautiful image, but it makes you think and it's showing you something. And he certainly is unique and certainly has his own thing going on. And, you know, it's odd. Well, I'll make a comparison to it, and it's interesting too, because William Eggleston did make some short films, and they are weird if you've ever seen them. I prefer his photography personally, but you know, if you look at some of the things that he inspired, and I think this is really obvious with film directors, if you're looking for you know, something that's more traditional, something that's very beautiful, something that's very Spielbergian, or if that's a word, or very Disney, you're not going to find it. I mean, what you're going to find is David Lynch, or you're going to find, you know, the people that really push that envelope of the bizarre. I think Sofia Coppola at times, you know, unlike her father, she pushes in that direction. And I think you certainly see the influence on her work you know, in terms of Eggleston, you know, his color aesthetic. And I say it because she has mentioned him being an influence, but, you know, it's this David Byrne, David Lynch kind of school of what they're going for, you know, and very much an outsider. And I think that if you consider those things, and actually let me say one more point in there as well, you know, there were several commissions that Eggleston had some interesting fun with. One of them was when Jimmy Carter was running for president. He was hired by the campaign committee to do some shots of Carter. And basically what he did is he goes out to Georgia in the town that Jimmy Carter was from and shoots a bunch of old abandoned buildings, returns the payment, and publishes them on his own and makes this bizarre political statement. There's no people in any of these photos. It's just kind of a statement of, you know, here's America, despite the fact I'm supposed to be shooting an election. So it's very interesting. He was also commissioned to go shoot Graceland after Elvis had died. And there's a series of shots of Graceland and the strange opulence of it. I mean, it's right up Eggleston's alley and the weird color nature of all of it. And, you know, I think without Eggleston, you don't have people, you know, like Gregory Crutzen or some of these great colorists that are working now that have this sense of space, this sense of, you know, an impersonal nature with people sometimes, but still telling a story. And I've never heard Crutzen directly refer to Eggleston as an influence. I'm assuming that. But I really think that without that piece, the history of photography is completely different. So anyway, I know this has been kind of a long-winded episode and a lot to get through today, but I hope you guys have found it somewhat interesting. And we're going to pick up here next week. And anyway, that's it for today. So once again, guys, thank you for watching The Art of Photography. I'll see you next